Hey everyone, in this video, I'm going to give you 4 tips for making a good scientific poster for your next poster session or conference. Hey everyone, I am Brian from the Grants and Publications YouTube channel. You know, a scientific poster presentation is often the first type of scientific presentation that early career researchers will give. Before you write a journal article, before you write a senior thesis, usually you're going to give a poster during a poster session at a conference, either a local meeting or a national or even an international meeting. And the poster session is something that you'll be doing for a long time, you know, all through graduate school, all through postdoc, even when you're a professor or an industry scientist. If you go to a meeting, there's a good chance you'll present a poster. Now, a lot of the posters I see at these conferences are really not very good. It makes people not want to stop and talk to you about your research. And the whole point of you presenting at this poster session is for people to stop and talk to you, learn about your research. That's the only way it has impact. If they learn about it, then they can cite it and promote it to their colleagues. So you really want to have people stop and talk to you. So having a visually attractive poster is really a big part of that. So let's get into it. Tip number one, before you start to make your poster, read the instructions for the poster session. Different poster sessions, are in different rooms. They have different sizes of boards to put the posters up on. And so there are a lot of different sizes. Sometimes they're wide and not very tall. Sometimes they're tall and not very wide. The point is you need to know what size the final poster is going to be before you start making it. So before you open PowerPoint and start making and dropping in your figures and text, figure out what size it needs to be. Now, I've been to poster sessions where people did not read the instructions. This is how I know about this. And then I would see posters that are overlapping the posters next to them. Right? And you don't want to be that person who made their poster too wide and you have to cover up your neighbor's poster to fully unroll yours. They're not going to like that. I've also been to poster sessions where I've seen posters that were built in this orientation and they had to hang it like this. So they had to hang their poster sideways because they didn't read the instructions and they made it too wide. Now, imagine getting people to stop and read your poster when they have to, stand sideways to read it. That's going to be hard to do. Tip number two is, in order to make sure your poster is not visually overwhelming and scaring people away, make sure you leave at least 25% white space. Okay, so what is white space? White space is just the unfilled space between paragraphs or between figures. 25% might sound like a lot of white space, but it's really not that much. Keep in mind that a poster is a very visual medium, right? It's not meant to be read. You're not asking people to stand there and read your poster like they would read your journal article. So you want to make sure it's very visually appealing. If you don't leave enough white space, what happens is the poster is just visually overwhelming and people don't want to commit to looking at it. They don't want to be stuck talking to you for 45 minutes at a poster session. They want to be in and out in 5 minutes so that they can see as many posters as they want to during that session. So leaving white space is really important to keep it from being that intimidating thing that nobody wants to see. Tip number three, limit the amount of text you put on the poster. So as I said in tip number two, posters are a visual medium. They're not a written medium. They are a visual medium. So keep your text short. You can't just go into your manuscript that you're getting ready to submit and pull out a paragraph from the introduction and put it onto your poster. That's not going to fly. It's too many words. People don't like to see giant blocks of text on a poster. That doesn't make them want to stop and talk to you. So cut it down severely. You know, cut it down by 50%, 75% is even better. You can use bullet points. That's perfectly fine on a poster. You can even use sentence fragments on a poster. That's okay too, if they're in your bullet points. The thing is, you want the reader or the viewer, if you're talking to them, to be able to get through the poster very quickly. And if they can get through it very quickly, then they're going to be more likely to stay and ask you questions and dive deeper. So limit that amount of text. Don't try to put your entire manuscript on a poster. Tip number four is you want to make sure you think about the layout and make a very logical layout for your poster. So you want to include a lot of the same elements that you will in your manuscript. So you need some background, you need some knowledge gaps, you need some research, a research question at least, as the figures and tables come up. Go ahead and add just one or two sentences of discussion. Logical layout also includes using columns carefully. Okay, so if you're going to use columns, which is a good idea because, you know, it's hard to read all the way across a poster and then follow the next line all the way across the poster, but measure those columns. So if you have three columns, they should either be all the exact same size, or maybe the center column is wider and the two outer columns are smaller. But if in that case, make sure that you measure them and you know, make sure that they are proportional. People read top to bottom, then they come back up, top to bottom, back up, and top to bottom. So don't go zigzagging. I've actually seen a poster in a poster session where the order of the figures was, you know, down, then up, then right, and then down to the left. It just didn't make any sense at all. It was nearly impossible to follow the flow of the poster. So use a logical layout. That was tip number four, but I actually have a bonus tip for you. Before I get to that bonus tip, I would just like to say, if you're getting value from this video, please hit the thumbs up, smash the like button. And if you'd like to see more videos about scientific writing topics and grants and publications, consider subscribing to the channel. And if you have topics or questions that you would like me to cover, you can leave those in the comments, or any suggestions that you have, you can leave those in the comments. Okay, here's your bonus tip. Tip number five, think about readability. So the viewers of your poster should be able to stand back and still be able to read it. They should be able to stand 6 feet away, that's 2 meters, and still be able to read the text. Because when you have a really popular poster, you're going to have a crowd of people standing around you, and the people in the back still want to be able to see what you're pointing at as you're delivering your poster presentation. So the font size needs to be large enough that the viewers can see it from that distance. Again, that's 6 feet or 2 meters distance. Also think about the font itself. So do you want to use a sans serif font or a serif font? The sans serif fonts, those are they don't have the little extensions at the bottom of the letters. Those are easier to read. So just like leaving white space, you know, using a big enough font and using a font that's very readable is going to be helpful to your reader. Also think about your color schemes in terms of readability. You know, choose colors that have, you know, pleasing qualities, they have enough contrast to distinguish the text from the background. And think about people that might be colorblind and they can't see certain colors. Red and green primarily are the issues with colorblind folks. And so if you do have someone like that viewing your poster, how is it going to look to them? Another aspect for readability is the background of your poster. If you want to use a photograph or a map or something like that as the background, you know, it's a clever idea. It's a creative idea. I've wanted to do that before, but then when I tried it out, it just made it so that the patterns in the background interfered with my figures and tables, and it just didn't work. On rare occasion, that kind of a background will work, but most of the time it's just not going to be allow enough readability. So be careful about choosing your background. Thank you for watching the video. I hope it was helpful to you. I'll see you next time, and happy writing.